that's been incredible for me as far as the intensity, the passion, and the energy is St. Louis and Minnesota. It's also the dueling banjos of the coaches, you know, the psychological warfare, the propaganda going back and forth.
Well, Ken Hitchcock's very frustrated right now because he feels like his better offensive players, Steen, Tarasenko, they don't have a lot of room out there. Minnesota has been, you know, really shutting these guys down with the exception of Game 2. And, you know, last night the Blues are shut out again. I mean, that's been their history the last couple years in Game 3s. They've blown 2-0 series leads the last couple years, and last night they were clearly the second-best team. We've talked about it many times on here about their goaltending. They can't figure out who their goalie is. You know, a few years ago, they trade for Halak. He's not the answer. Then they go and they say, okay, we're going to give it to Elliott. He's not the answer. Last year, they trade for Ryan Miller. That doesn't work out. Now they're going with a kid, Jake Vaughn. That's four different starting goalies in four different playoff runs in 4 years. That's just not going to work in this NHL. You need a guy that's going to step up his game. And again, the Blues, Devin Dubnyk's the better goalie once again, and the Blues continue to, you know, be a playoff disappointment.
I don't think that Allen has been anything short of very good there, Eric, in fairness to him. I think they had two open net goals in the one game,
yep.
And it's been 2-1, and a shutout.
3-0 in an empty net goal yesterday, yep.
Yeah. So I think Jake Allen has done quite nicely, but I still agree with you. When you don't know who your goalie is, it has a terrible effect on the team. And I think Hitchcock is coaching his last series in St. Louis.
So based on what we're saying here, Bill, you think there's going to be a lot of changes in the offseason? Because you've said a few times, and when it comes to goalies, coaches, players, that they're going to be moving somewhere else. You think that a lot of casualties in the first round are going to create a lot of changes in the offseason?
Well, I mean, you have to look at what Hitchcock has accomplished. He can't get that team to play well enough to win the first round, and they're winning their division, they're winning their conference. That's because they're playing the type of game in the regular season that they have to step up in the playoffs, and they can't step it up.
Right.
And I'm not blaming Hitch, but he's a 5-year coach who should have quit after 3. They get tired of him.
But you know what?
They get tired of him.
Hitchcock is a very good coach. He's got great credentials. He has an impeccable resume. He's been around a long time. He's done very well, and he did okay with the tools that he had in Philadelphia. He's been around a long time. The problem is that he gets himself all worked up, and last night he was embarrassing to himself in the interview. He should shut up.
Yeah, he was pretty pissed off after last night, no doubt about it.
It ain't going to change things like the press and entertaining the reporters, because that's all you're fucking doing. You're entertaining the reporters, and it ain't helping you. Actually, I believe it's more detrimental, because you're pissing off the officials, and you're pissing people off. You should just shut the fuck up and be the coach that you are, and he's a good coach.
Bill, is Hitchcock one of these guys like John Tortorella who brings that real intensity to the game, but it burns out on players after a while? The book on Tort seemed to be short-term gain and then long-term pain. Is Hitchcock in that same mold?
I would say so. Yeah, and in fairness to both, Frank just said, they're both successful coaches. Their style is a successful style on the very short term. But when you start getting into 5 and 6 years with this guy, you've had enough. You've had enough. Whether you're an assistant of his, whether you're one of his players, whether you're one of his fringe players, you get tired of the same mortician's look that Hitch has. Life is just about to end behind the St. Louis bench. That's the feeling I get, and that's why they don't play with any enthusiasm. They're worn out.
Bill, is it up to a coach to change his style? I mean, because, you know, I was just reading, and it's a different coach, but a number of 49ers have come out and said, you know what, Jim Harbaugh wore his welcome. He rode us too hard. It just seems with a guy like Hitch or Torts, they're such a disciplinarian, and they come in there with, you know, this, you know, you got to do this, you got to do this, this barking and barking, and it doesn't change. So after a while, the player's like, wait a second, you know, I've been hearing the same song and dance here for 3-4 years. Enough's enough already. Isn't it up to the coach to sort of change that and adapt who he is as a coach?
Well, I think guys like Hitch and Tortorella and Pat Burns, those guys who are very tough, very smart guys, know the game. They're very good for the rookies. I think a young guy coming into the NHL needs that type of dictatorship and that type of totalitarian coaching with an iron fist. But the guys who are the veterans who have been around a long time, they'll accept it. You know, they're getting paid. But after a couple of years of that shit, they'll say, "Fuck you. Mm-hmm. Hey, we don't need this. We've made our bones. We've earned our stripes. We don't need this kind of ridicule and rhetoric and bullshit." And another guy who's part of that club is Keenan. Keenan was very, mm-hmm. man Keenan. And like I said, the rookies, they're in awe at the beginning because these guys really know the game. They have experience. They have the brand of being a winning coach. But I believe the veterans will play along with it. But up 2 years with no result, they'll end up. You see, Scotty Bowman was tolerated because he got results. So if I brought a bunch of the guys that talked to me about Scotty Bowman, they said he was the biggest prick that ever lived behind the bench, but he got results.
Yeah, the line about Scotty Bowman, we hated him 364 days a year. The 365th day, we got our Stanley Cup ring. So,
have a look at the teams that Scotty Bowman coached.
They were all great.
Have a look at Scotty Bowman, the coach. He was very successful when he had outstanding players.
Yep.
Anything short of that was an unmitigated disaster.
That's a good point. It's the same in the NBA, right? It's the same with a guy like Phil Jackson. Yeah, Phil Jackson wins championships with the Lakers with Kobe in his prime and Shaq in his prime and the Bulls when Jordan and Pippen are in their prime, but you put them with the Knicks and they're still winning 10 games a year, right? I mean, sometimes a coach is only as good as his best players.
Well, I mean, the coaching position is a temporary position anyway. And I think with the term and the money that's being thrown at the players, it's a lot easier to just look at the coach and say, you know what, I can wait this guy out. I'm going to be here next year because I'm making a zillion dollars. The coach, he can be sacked.
Yeah,
I hope there aren't too many like that, but you're probably right. There's a group of guys that know how to play the game, but I would like to think that winning is first and foremost, and if they don't like the way the coach is treating them as a group, they should make it known to the general manager as opposed to keeping it to themselves.